Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's our special subject for April 2022, Sex, Satire, and American Culture. We'll be discussing Artists and Models, directed by Frank Tashlin, and Kiss Me Stupid, directed by Billy Wilder.
So a Dean Martin double feature. So this was my special subject.
That's right, Elise. Let us know what the link is here and what we're going to be accomplishing.
Well, I don't know if I want to be exact with goals or anything like that.
A thesis statement.
So the title is a reference to Camille Paglia's 1990s essay collection, Sex, Art, and American Culture, back when she still had a mind. Anyway, I enjoyed them at the time. I was in my early 20s, or late teens even. In this case, what I'm referring to is that Tashlin and Wilder are both known as satirists of American culture, and in this particular case, they are both dealing with American pop culture, among other things. Sex! So there you go. Which is interesting, given how much Tashlin worked with Jerry Lewis, who is not a sexual presence in films in any kind of conventional way.
Didn't he come from cartoons?
Jerry Lewis?
No, Tashlin.
Yes, Tashlin did come from cartoons.
So Jerry Lewis was a little closer to actual corporeal reality than cartoons, but only a little closer.
Yes. I mean, I think that's the approach that Tashlin took. What's interesting, though, is that he and Lewis went on to frequently collaborate and really, really collaborate. There is bleed between the movies ostensibly directed by Tashlin and the movies Lewis directed that he also wrote and starred in, his total filmmaker movies, in that Lewis is always developing the same set of ideas, regardless of whether he's in a Tashlin film or his own film, and that's certainly not true of any other movies that he appears in.
Was he alternating back and forth, or once he starts directing, does he no longer work with Tashlin?
No, he keeps working with Tashlin, right up until basically the end of his popularity in the mid-60s.
You're a great Jerry Lewis expert.
I wrote a giant essay for Bright Lights Film Journal that we'll link to. I also wrote a giant essay on Billy Wilder and romantic comedy. We can link to that too for Bright Wall Dark Room.
And Jerry Lewis is a real blind spot in my filmic knowledge. I avoided him whenever possible growing up.
So did I up until, well, I can tell that story, but go on.
I just never had my phase of, oh wait, Jerry Lewis is a genius. I've never had that phase.
That's too bad because it's a very fun place to go to.
Yes, I realize it's a stage in most cinephile biographies.
Well, I don't know. I wouldn't call it a stage. It's just a door I went through.
Yes, and you're still there.
Yeah, I mean, I was pretty obsessed for several years. I read and wrote a lot. At this point, it's an obsession of the past, but the enthusiasm remains.
Right, so lay out Jerry Lewis's career for us.
Whoa, okay. So Martin Lewis team up in the mid-40s in Atlantic City, the 500 Club, and they meteorically rise to fame. Soon they become a very popular New York nightclub act. They're playing to a very sophisticated audience, obviously. There are those aficionados of Martin and Lewis who say that this was the only time they were good. Because, of course, Jerry Lewis has a very, as we've already alluded to, has a very ambivalent place in American culture and in film criticism, particularly American film criticism. But I obviously didn't see that act. I did not time travel into the past and see that act. What I know them from that period, or soon afterwards, is their Colgate Comedy Hour appearances. That would be the thing closest to the nightclub act that you can still see. And it is phenomenally different from their movies. I know many who are, you know, prominent Martin and Lewis fans who are big fans of their movies, but that's not me. I love the TV appearances. Of their movies, it is widely considered that the two that they made with Tashlin are the best from just a cinephile standpoint. These were mostly thrown out into the ether by Hal Wallace to capitalize on their proto-Beatles-esque popularity.
They had their own comic book, The Adventures of Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin, or Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis, I forget which way it is.
There were a few years where they were the highest paid entertainers in America.
They were the Carmen Mirandas of the 50s. Where does his career go from here? When does he start directing movies?
Oh, sure.
What are the Tashlin movies that he does while he's in the midst of directing his own movies? I just don't have a good sense of what is what.
Well, Artists and Models is close to the end, and Tashlin also made, I believe, their very last movie. Here, let me just get on Jerry Lewis's career page to refresh my memory. Yeah, so Tashlin did direct their next movie, which is only the following year, Hollywood or Bust, and famously their partnership fell apart on the set of Partners, which is also 1956, not Tashlin. Immediately afterwards, Lewis makes solo films. He's not directing them yet, though, but as a star. And in 1958, he starts making some more with Tashlin. And then in 1960, he directs himself in his own screenplay, The Bellboy.
So that's the first one.
That's the first one, but he keeps on making movies with Tashlin and others, but the most notable ones are made by him or by Tashlin. And yes, his popularity, you know, like many entertainers of his generation, with the 60s generation gap, by the end of the mid-60s, it's in severe decline. And so is he.
What's the big 60s Tashlin movie?
Well, there's a lot, but my favorite, which we don't have on the schedule yet, but I should try to get it in there for, I don't know what, 15 years from now. My own favorite is The Disorderly Orderly. That's from 1964. That's the last one they did together.
Okay. And Dean Martin. I'm a big fan of Dean Martin.
Well, yes, and you recently listened to some podcasts about him, so your memory is fresher on Martin's post-Lewis career than mine is.
Right. Well, he's all over the place right now. So there was a You Must Remember This series that prominently featured Dean Martin. It was about Sammy Davis Jr. and Dean Martin. There was also a big two-hour documentary on TCM about Dean Martin sort of rediscovering how magnificent his career was.
Well, why don't you give us some of the post-Lewis highlights of Dean Martin's film career?
Kind of universally agreed upon, and I see no reason to disagree, that he really only had a brief golden age.
It's the same as Lewis, and I think it's the same period.
It's even briefer in terms of aesthetic greatness, although I would probably argue, but there's not really a way to argue it because I don't have a good handle on the greatness of the Jerry Lewis movies that he made himself. But he was considered just, oh, he's just a straight man. He's not part of why that act is so amazing. Then I guess you always have your contrarians who say, oh no, Dean Martin is the one that made the act.
It's like Sternberg and Dietrich, blah, 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 etc. They're both great.
But Dean Martin himself was not an ambitious man. And that's certainly always part of the biographical information you get about him, right? He wanted to coast whenever he could. He liked to play golf. And for whatever reason, in the late 50s, because he lost this meal ticket, his pairing with Jerry Lewis, he kind of had to do something, just stumbled into appearing in some of the greatest movies ever made.
And happened to have some natural dramatic talent.
Well, yeah, he's a big part of these great movies. Like, Some Came Running is probably the greatest, but Rio Bravo also, as a Western hater, I just think it's an amazing movie anyway. And it's got John Wayne in it. It's got all the things I don't want to see, but I still love it. Then he switches back into neutral in the 60s, becomes part of the Rat Pack. Those movies,
oh, right,
I guess, have their defenders.
Well, obviously Kiss Me Stupid makes references to that.
Yeah, I mean, Kiss Me Stupid is late flowering of the Dean Martin persona, but here he's going back to, he's not really using any of the dramatic skills that he puts over in Rio Bravo or Some Came Running. This is just kind of honing his nightclub persona to perfection and allowing it to be deployed in a really crazy way by Billy Wilder. You know, his career, it's perfect for him. He's just on TV throughout the 60s into the 70s. You know, for the last decade of his career, he's mostly just hosting roasts where he has to say a few words and then he lets Don Rickles insult people and that's about it. And he got a fat paycheck for that. And that was still going on, you know, when we were kids, at least.
Much like the Jerry Lewis telethon.
That's where I first learned about Jerry Lewis.
And me too.
You know, actually, the first time I saw Jerry Lewis was that movie Slapstick of Another Kind.
Oh, dear.
What an awful movie that was.
I must have seen that at some point, too. That's interesting, though, because that's arguably, or anyway, I would argue that 1964 is the last year that Jerry Lewis made in arguably great movies, which is his own The Patsy and Tashlin's The Disorderly Orderly. Although, of course, there are Lewis fanatics out there who will argue for it all.
It makes sense, right? 1964 is the end of, okay, you're a cool 50s guy.
Exactly.
You're a square by 1965.
And then what do you do when you've been relying on the goodwill of an audience that loves you for so long? Like, comedians need that.
Right.
And so do, you know, other entertainers, singers.
And it does seem to have gone a little better for Dean Martin, just maybe because he was so much less ambitious. Just host this Dean Martin TV show.
Lewis is anguished over his career and over his reputation.
Right.
He's a self-conscious artist. Dean Martin, I think, had a lot of private torment, but I don't know if we need to get into this.
No.
We do have a bit of knowledge for once, and so we're going to share it. But I was going to say, to apply all of this to artists and models. So the Martin and Lewis persona established in their movies, which has nothing to do with them in their TV appearances, which are all sketches, and therefore presumably nothing to do with their nightclub act. But once you put them in a narrative, what happens is that Lewis becomes this innocent childlike figure, and Martin becomes sort of knowing, cynical, manipulative figure who's also a ladies' man. In their TV appearances, often, I mean, it changes because Lewis' character evolves over the years, but certainly initially and often, and one strain of it all the way to the end, is that the Lewis character is an aggressive roughhouser, just untrammeled id. And although to a certain extent he's always applying this against the Martin figure, the straight man, the quote-unquote straight man, the heteronormative man who's like what conventional masculinity is supposed to be, to a certain extent he's attacking and disrupting that. But at the same time, there's always a sense, sometimes written into the sketch and sometimes just in the manner with which Martin plays it, that ultimately they are friends and allies against the rest of the world. And the very, very first Colgate Comedy Hour sketch where they introduce themselves, they are absolutely presented as, oh, it's a very Marx Brothers kind of thing, the Jew and the Italian working class crashers of a high class boss party,
right,
who just burst in and ruin it. And they are absolutely allies and completely tight. Now, what Lewis does in these movies with Martin, this childlike character, which is not very similar to what he does in his solo films, or even with Tashlin after this, I don't like it. This is my least favorite version of Jerry Lewis. Even so?
Well, he's basically Gilligan.
Yeah, kind of. Except he's gay. I mean, we have to talk about sex and gender in this movie.
Of course. Obviously, that's why you picked it, right?
Well, first of all, tell me what your impression of it was. Have you seen it before?
I saw it a long time ago. I didn't remember it very well because, as I kept telling you, oh yeah, I remember Shirley MacLaine in that bee costume. It's a bat costume. Mm-hmm. I mean, I remember she wore a costume.
Well, she's
least.
Sort of like an insect lady, though, too.
I didn't remember much else about the movie.
She's got all these crazy things sticking out of her head. You seem to enjoy it while we were watching it.
It's funny. There's no doubt. I mean, Jerry Lewis screaming every time he dreams, it did make me laugh every time. It's like a radio tuning in on his insane frequency.
That's sort of as crazy as he lets himself get in this movie. That's the thing. The stage Lewis is much more consistent. Out of control. And so is he in some of the later Tashlin movies. Anyhow, both of these movies are making a lot of references to the real people's lives who appear in them. Well, Kiss Me Stupid, more to what the Dean Martin persona is.
Which is a constructed persona that post-dates these Lewis and Martin films, right? He didn't have this image as America's great drunken singer until after Lewis left the act. It's when he went to Vegas, he's like, well, I need something, so I'm just going to be drunk all the time. And he wasn't drunk all the time. He just pretended to be drunk.
America's greatest drunken and rapey nightclub performer. That is in Kiss Me Stupid. But here in Artists and Models, you can see, I don't know if the audience was supposed to be recognizing this. I can't imagine so. But you can definitely see references to Martin and Lewis's real life relationship.
Well, yeah, they're from Steubendale, which is a reference to Dean Martin's hometown.
Oh, well, everyone, the audience would certainly know
exactly.
That. So there's lots of references to Martin's past in particular.
Which is like an Italian industrial enclave in Ohio.
Yeah. Lewis is, of course, from New Jersey.
But not in this movie. They're both from Steubendale.
Sure. Their relationship is basically portrayed in this movie as a gay relationship.
Yeah, they have a breakup scene right at the beginning, and Jerry Lewis
The word divorce is used.
Guilts him out of it.
With tears. And the audience would know, probably, they would have heard that there was tensions between America's sweethearts, everybody's favorite couple.
Yeah. Yeah, and soon they would break up, and it would be perhaps the most acrimonious parting of ways in the history of double acts.
And it was like the Beatles breaking up. Like, America was devastated.
Yeah.
And Malone and MacLaine are presented as doubles of them, basically, in their own gay relationship.
Right.
Like, Malone is the artist. You think from the title Artists and Models, and from the opening credits, which we should talk about, that this is going to be about male objectification of women, right? And male artists getting sleazy. But that's not the case. The artist in question is Dorothy Malone, and her model is Shirley MacLaine, and they live together in their own cute little Bert and Ernie twin beds.
Yeah.
In their own Greenwich Village apartment. Both of those apartments with their skylights. Or what do you call that? I don't know. You know, those big Greenwich Village apartment windows. Absolutely gorgeous. I mean, the film looks gorgeous.
Yeah, they're supposed to be broke.
Right.
We could only dream of being so broke.
The woman who plays the landlady, it took me a while to recognize her, but I believe that was frequent Jerry Lewis collaborator Kathleen Freeman, who just keeps working with him and with Tashlin. They make a fantastic pairing in The Ladies' Man, but she's uncredited in this, so I don't know if this was a Tashlin regular or what, or if this is the first time she shows up in his work. I don't know. But yeah, I was talking about the opening credits. I've watched the movie several times, but I think this is the first time I noticed how all of those models in those ridiculous poses with all the drapery, how they're breaking character. They're breaking their pose.
Yeah, each one near the end cracks up.
Yeah.
They're laughing at whoever is objectifying them.
Yeah, I don't know if this is Tashlin cracking jokes or what's going on there. So both of these movies share in common that they seem to be about objectification, but really they are undermining that.
Oh, yeah.
So with these two pairs that we have, Tashlin's really exaggerating something that occurs in all of the Martin and Lewis movies, which is trying to figure out what to do with gender and sexuality in these movies, because in the sketch, it's just the two of them, and they're basically in love no matter what they're doing, right? But you have to if you put them in a movie narrative, like a stupid, basic, standard movie narrative, which is what these little quickies are, they have to have some kind of romantic interest. So Martin gets the big girl romantic interest, and Lewis gets someone who's supposed to mirror him. And sometimes he's also doing, kind of being a little bit voyeuristic, almost in sort of some kind of Oedipal complex with Martin and his grown-up girlfriend, where you aren't exactly sure who he's jealous of and might want to just like get in there with both of them. Except in a very, very naive, asexual, innocent way.
Well, right? There's that Twister game.
Oh, that, yeah.
What a crazy scene.
Practically every scene is some kind of sexual joke that I'm not sure if the original audience would have gotten. So I don't know what Tashlin is doing here, but this is just the way he works with the plastic material of the performers that he actually has on hand. And then note Shirley MacLaine talking about astrology and numerology. I'm thinking it was written for her character because that's who she was.
I don't know if that's true in 1955. I think she got into that stuff in the 80s, but maybe I'm wrong.
No, I think you're wrong. I think this is the evidence that she was into it in 1955. All of the movie's signals about sex and gender are conflicting. Like it's like the turn of the screw. It doesn't add up to one whole text that can make sense. But like every single scene is commenting on and particularly examining, like over and over again, there are jokes made to the effect of Martin's character unconsciously being attracted to his roommate, telling Dorothy Malone that she reminds him of Eugene just before he kisses her for the first time. But then that's always put in some kind of safe box, like you sound like him, but you don't look like him. But particularly there is this examination of the Jerry Lewis figure's sexuality. Obviously, starting with the first scene between them that ends in the near divorce, we're just given a heteronormative gender typical depiction of somebody's idea of a gay relationship where one is the man and one is the woman out of the two men, right? Jerry is making dinner for them. Jerry has got his apron on. Martin is just complaining and lashing out at him and blah, blah, blah. And I want to move on almost like I want to get out of this gay relationship that's holding me back somehow here. When Lewis just sings that when you pretend number. I mean, his mannerisms are just out of control. Like, I don't know. I feel like something is being very much telegraphed there. I have no idea what Jerry Lewis's real sexuality was, because comedian sexuality is very, very complicated. And so is the double act. I mean, the kind of sexuality projected by the comedian's persona, right? But there's no doubt about it that Lewis just keeps exploring this gay character, basically. His relationship to women and femininity. Most spectacularly in his movie. A lot of this gets into my essay, which is about work and gender, the relationship between work and gender in Lewis's films. Most spectacularly in the Tashlin movie Rockabye Baby, which is a loose adaptation of The Miracle of Morgan's Creek, and in The Ladies Man. And there are rough sketches for The Ladies Man scenes in this movie. The Bat Lady basically turns into Miss Cartilage, and the glorious, glorious scene, possibly my favorite scene in any movie of all time, where Shirley MacLaine freakishly tries to seduce him while singing Inamorata. That turns into the Miss Cartilage sequence, fantasy sequence in The Ladies Man, which starts with this creature, bat, I guess, hanging upside down from the ceiling, looking like she's got a asphyxiation costume on from an S&M club when Herbert Hebert first encounters her, and then has a dance routine with her. I mean, they're both magnificent scenes, but what Shirley MacLaine does in this sequence, in this movie, gives it a bit of an edge for me. Just her own exploitation of her own weirdness. And she really outdoes Lewis for weirdness in this movie. Because he's doing his relatively innocent, kind of comic book version of his persona. Not going nearly as far as she does. So for me, she just steals the movie away from him, really. But I was admiring the work that he does with her more in this viewing and realizing how much of it is rough drafts for things that appear in his later movies.
Yeah, it's got a certain element of the June Alice and Mickey Rooney treat me rough scene,
but also
Girl Crazy,
but also completely otherworldly.
Well, that's a pretty otherworldly scene. I don't know if you've seen it lately.
Yeah, well, see, this is the thing. Like, Tashlin and Lewis are building on these ordinary comedy tropes, these common comedy tropes of things like the tomboy and the shy kind of teenage boy with arrested development, right? But then they're taking them into a new stratosphere. Speaking of arrested development, maybe we should start talking about what comic books have to do in this movie.
Among other things, it is definitely a commentary, kind of a pro, sounds like a bit of a pro Wortham commentary on comic books. It seems to be taking the same line that the people who were criticizing comic books at the time.
No, but think about it though. First of all, I don't think Tashlin actually cares about what comic books are doing to American society.
No, but he's not taking pains to defend the greatness of comic book art either, right?
The satire of it is the accurate commentary on what America wants, I guess, really. And America's children, in this case, specifically. But that becomes a kind of meta-comment on, well, what does America really want right now? Also, besides comic books, what do American's children really... Well, they want Martin and Lewis.
Right. You get it in a nutshell with Jerry Lewis. He thinks he wants to tell stories about cute little benign creatures that live...
Mousy Mouse and Goosey Goose.
Subconsciously, he just has endless reels of gore rolling across his dreamscape, and he doesn't remember any of it. Only Dean Martin knows about it because he can't sleep through the screaming.
And yes, and all of that stuff is, again, further kind of fear of women and castration stuff, but like very obviously so, but then at the same time, a fascination, which he also plays on in just such a genius way, plays on this trope in which becomes the movie The Ladies Man in his dance sequence or whatever the hell it is with Shirley MacLaine.
But this is all fueled by Dorothy Malone's comic book. However, we're told that Dorothy Malone is under fire because she's not going far enough. So it's Jerry Lewis's imagination that is going the places where the publisher wants to go.
That's true.
The federal government says otherwise. Senate subcommittees are coming down like a ton of bricks on the comic book industry at this very time. And that's the cultural background to all of this, which presumably a lot of people would have known about, whether they collected comic books or not. In the audience, they would have known that it was in the news that comic books were a cause of juvenile delinquency and arrested development of all types.
So I guess the idea is, and this is the only time a Martin and Lewis movie is used this way, in this kind of meta way, other than Hollywood or Bust, the idea is that American culture produces Jerry Lewis. Jerry Lewis is America, basically.
Well, it does, but it also produces the cultural gatekeepers who are trying to head this off. But they're going about it in a way that is also kind of stunted.
Right, because Lewis is brought over to their side and becomes...
Oh, very easily.
Well, he can be brought over to any side.
They made me a word that is not supposed to be said on the internet anymore.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But then he explains that what he means by that is that he was so slow in school that he was going to summer school in the winter.
Right.
That is a fantastic piece of monologue writing where you can see, and I know Lewis, I mean, I know Lewis's writing from other movies. I know he certainly must have contributed to that, where you can see how sophisticated the character really is. No, I don't mean the character. I mean the writing of the character.
Right.
You know, how sophisticated the comedy is. But then, too, it's not just that America is an idiot. America is also a genius. And this is also true of Hollywood or Bust, which some critics think is the unacknowledged basis of Rain Man.
Okay.
It has basically the same plot, with Tom Cruise playing the Dean Martin character.
Okay. Well, I don't know. Is that such a great claim to fame? I'm sure it's better than Rain Man.
Well, yes, it is. But what I mean, why I'm saying that, what I mean by that, is that the Lewis character is also an idiot savant, which explains, I guess, why he's got mathematical formulas for space stations beamed directly into his head from the ether.
Right. Now, comic book fans would recognize that this is a nod, it seems to me anyway, to Johnny Quick, speedster of the 40s and early 50s, who attained super speeds just by saying aloud a magic series of numbers that were uncovered in an Egyptian tomb.
So the timeline is right for that? These comics appeared in time for this to be a reference?
Oh, yeah. I think Johnny Quick was canceled in 1954, so he would be old news by then. But he's the only one I know of that has a magic formula like that. It just really stuck out. Get this international spy plot going based on the fact that there's a magic formula that keeps space stations vital in the stratosphere or in the outer regions. I don't know exactly how that works.
It's nonsense.
It's comic
book nonsense. It's comic book nonsense.
It's very Cold War.
And it gives an excuse for yet another hot 50s blonde to show up.
Man, Eva Gabor rules. She's such a great Gabor. She's so much better than Zsa Zsa. I feel like Zsa Zsa's more famous for some reason. It doesn't make any sense.
And there's that extraordinary scene. Well, here, let's talk about Eva Gabor in this movie. So our blondes include Dorothy Malone, of course, but then also Anita Ekberg shows up.
Amazing.
As one of Martin's exes who lives in the building. Yes, then Eva Gabor. We need to branch off into talking about, again, gender and sexuality and Jerry Lewis in these scenes and how Tashlin is or is not, I don't even know, I don't have a thesis about it, bringing this together with this idea of an infantilized America that is hyperfixated on big-breasted blondes, basically. Which he also uses Jane Mansfield in some of his other movies.
Will success spoil Rock Hunter?
Yeah, and yeah, the girl can't help it. I don't even know that he makes them work together. He just brings them together because they're two things he's fascinated with, I think. So what is going on with Lewis's sexuality in this movie? Because he's in love with the Bat Lady, who is not a real woman and who is sexy but terrifying. So he fetishizes her, right? He fetishizes the Bat Lady and then has nightmares about being destroyed by someone who's kind of like his imagination's version of the Bat Lady, right? The lavender-eyed woman with the eye in the back of her head,
right?
Who comes after Vincent Vulture,
yeah,
and causes gore to ooze out of his tail.
Yeah,
he's afraid of actual Betsy, who portrays or models for the Bat Lady, right? Shirley MacLaine, who is a girl of his own age and of his own sort of autistic and androgynous nature. Yes, androgynous other than...
She's not particularly androgynous.
Other than her shape, but yes, Shirley MacLaine somehow, despite her shape, which is very emphasized in this movie, somehow always manages to project this pixie quality, right?
She just settled on him by a numerological process.
Well, it makes no sense otherwise why she would, you know, get obsessed with Jerry Lewis.
Right, but she is, and nothing can shake her devotion.
It's basically like saying the plot calls for it. She just knows that the plot calls for it.
Yeah. She invents some reasons why it's a good thing. You know, he's not good looking. Other women won't want him.
But then we get him in these scenes with Eva Gabor and also with Dorothy Malone when he kisses her thinking it's Shirley MacLaine, right? And in that case, he seems to be coming up to heterosexual snuff and in fact to be sort of hypersexual.
Well, his kisses with Shirley MacLaine are a big part of the plot, right? They make him overheat.
Well, that's no, that's.
And they make his shoes blow off.
Yeah, see, that too. I mean, he is theoretically afraid of. He's in love with the Bat Lady, but also terrified of her. And he's theoretically uninterested in Shirley MacLaine, like scared of her as a girl. But then when she forces herself on him, he seems to have a sexual reaction in spite of himself. But then he knowingly and consciously has a sexual reaction to these women he's supposed to, right? Eva Gabor type. But even that, I mean, I've watched this movie a lot and I've paid very close detailed attention to what it is doing, because it's doing something every moment with sex and gender. And even in the Eva Gabor scene, where he's basically being a cartoon character with his eyes bugging out of his head when she appears in the doorway, he starts imitating her voice, too, as part of his smittenness. And so, again, there is this play with gender and this idea of, you know, gay men diva-worshipping and kind of wanting to be this woman, right? And so he's, like, going back and forth in every moment between succeeding at heterosexuality and failing. And then they have this, and, like, hyper-succeeding at it. But she says to him that, no, there's nothing you can do for me. Like, she never has. He may be doubting what his sexuality is during this scene, but she never is. And then they have their exchange about the peewee and the kiwi.
Yeah, the Hungarian peewee and the Hungarian kiwi.
In Hungary, we do not have, what did she say? Peewees, only kiwi. She is calling him a peewee.
That's when she thinks she has to seduce Dean Martin. But then when she realizes that the formula actually is locked inside the brain of Jerry Lewis, then she does have to try to seduce him.
Well, here's the thing that Tashlin's movies often do with Lewis. Not invariably, but certainly just the disorderly orderly takes this even further, is even more formulaic about it, knowingly formulaic. So we started off this podcast series talking about Laura Mulvey and her male gaze theory of cinema, and that one particular article, Visual Pleasure and Cinematic Narrative, or whatever the hell it's called. And I keep remarking periodically on how many movies we've watched so far, and we have never actually come across a narrative that is Mulvey's Hollywood archetypal narrative, right? Which is the man sees the woman and wants to possess her because she is a beautiful passive object, and so he proves his mastery of the diegetic universe and wins her. The only time we ever saw a plot like that, it was a bad imitation of D.W. Griffith in a silent movie.
Right.
But Tashlin is working with this formula. So he raises all of these questions about Jerry Lewis's gender and sexuality in their movies, and then uses the plot to straighten him out. But it is done in such a way, and you know, often comedian movies are like this. In a sense, you can say Groundhog Day is that, right? But the way in which Bill Murray is being straightened out is just a little bit different, right? But we rely on comedians to be marginal, to be outside of conventional bounds, right? But then the movie narrative structure, to reassure you, has to bring them back into some kind of order by the end of it. Just the way it does with unruly women protagonists, too, often. So here, everything is working towards all of this jumble of confusion about gender and sexuality, and trying to get these two couples, who start out as two gay couples, trying to get them into heterosexual romances that are convincing by the end, right? The making of a man of Jerry Lewis is absolutely crucial to this happening in that climactic scene, right? Or our narrative anxiety about what he represents will remain, right?
When he recognizes the sexual impact of Shirley MacLaine on his life.
Yeah, and what does that do for him? It turns him into a fighter.
Right.
Because she looks like she's going to be rescuing him initially, right? When he's knocked out and she kisses him. And then as soon as he has this epiphany, which is brought about in part by the fact that he was just confronted with a fake Bat Lady, and then remembered how, I guess, her kiss in front of the water cooler felt different. Yeah, he doesn't kiss her during the dance sequence, does he? It all adds and builds up, and gradually he's thinking more and more and more about her. And after he gets a kiss from Eva Gabor and it's the wrong woman, he knows it's not going to work for him, then he realizes it's really been Betsy all along. And then she kisses him again, and then he transforms into this manic, bouncing, off-the-wall powerhouse of conventional masculine heroism. And it's punching everybody out. But then, of course, the punchline is that he nearly punches Dorothy Malone out, too.
Sure, once you get started, it's a berserker rage.
So I feel like it undermines itself still in that there's so much excess to the worm turning, that even that is outside of the bounds that Tashlin is pretending that we're adhering to here.
But the two homosexual pairings that you're talking about, I guess the handoff scene, or one of the handoff scenes, would have to be when Shirley MacLaine is rubbing Dorothy Malone's back.
Now then... you're getting it. Now you're reading it, Dave. You're reading the text.
Dean Martin comes up and he's not supposed to be there, so he's doing her back instead, and Shirley MacLaine retires from the scene.
And then there's all this confusion of voice.
How can you be over there when you're rubbing my back?
Yeah. Yeah, Tashlin's just like, what is he doing? He's just a crazy mad genius. What is he doing? Like, he's just exploring this in every single scene. This is...
Yeah, well, he definitely did some risky stuff, it seems to me, in the 50s. I mean, Susan Slept Here, is that his first movie?
I don't know. Let's look up Tashlin. Let's find out a little more about Tashlin.
We need to do that as a Christmas movie one day.
It's just hard to imagine anyone making art about pop culture figures who thinks about them and about American culture in general and its infantilism and its sex fixations, just thinks about them so thoroughly and is willing to examine them so minutely, knowing that the audience is going to miss 95% of what's happening. So this is like Will Rogers' satire. This is just for himself.
Well, yeah, but it's definitely, you have to assume that Tashlin was greedily gobbling up all of the Senate hearings and all of the cultural discourse on comic books. And he's putting it all back out there for us, but with his own ironic take on it. Obviously, he's not preaching at anybody. He's not angry about anything. He just thinks it's all hilarious. He doesn't think comic books are destroying America. He just thinks America's discussion over this whole thing reveals how insane it is on all sides of the debate.
Yeah, I mean, I think you can safely say that he thinks American culture is completely insane.
Right.
So yes, he starts out in Looney Tunes and Merry Melodies, particularly, he does a lot of Porky Pig.
And there's a link to Kiss Me Stupid there too, because Mel Blanc appears in Kiss Me Stupid, the voice of so many Looney Tunes characters.
Now let me see if I can find his first live action here. Susan Slept Here definitely isn't his first live action movie. In fact, it comes right before Artists and Models.
Well, yeah, sure. But how long had he been making non-cartoon films?
Looks like since 1952, fully credited.
Okay. But yeah, so he's thoroughly familiar with the world of cartooning.
So now that you know how to read these scenes, what do you make of the human pretzel / sandwich?
Let's
start by saying I have read academic essays about Lewis's work, and I'm stealing from them here. Parts that I agree with, and I cannot tell you where I'm getting them from at this point, but somebody in an essay pointed out that there's the scene where Lewis is posing for the now innocuous children's story of his that Dorothy Malone is going to illustrate because she's done with the horror of comic books because
Freddy
of all this
Field Mouse.
This demand for eroticized blood, basically, that she doesn't want to fulfill. She's fine with fulfilling the erotic side, but not the violent side.
Right, so she's just got the wrong idea.
Wrong idea altogether.
Wrong medium.
And like the little boy himself says in that scene, that boy with that hilarious voice, you think Cirque's kids are obnoxious. He says, Bat Lady's boring. So like just sex is boring to kids. They need the erotic thrill of violence. And this is very, obviously this is exactly the direction superhero comics eventually would go in.
Well, yeah, but...
Goodbye to the sex, hello to nothing but eroticized violence for the rest of all time.
I think it's interesting though, the way they sort of combine everything, right? Because the Flashpoint comics, the big offenders were not superhero comics. It was EC.
No, but that makes like Tashlin a prophet of where American culture is going to go with superhero comics.
Right, because superhero comics, there was some violence in it, but actually Wortham was most concerned about, you know, gay subtext in superhero comics.
Well, that's hilarious in this movie.
Exactly. That's what he mostly complained about. And
Batman and Robin, now how Martin and Lewis are they?
Right. Exactly. That's so much of what Wortham was saying, is that Batman is abusing his ward and like that kind of stuff. Superman, too, was a problem for Wortham because he believed that it was a fascist icon. Right? It encouraged the abdication of personal responsibility in readers and would create the kinds of citizens that would, once again...
Yeah, would create Jerry Lewis's.
Right, who would embrace a new fascism.
They probably will. But yes, I was saying there was this essay that points out that Lewis... The pose that Lewis assumes then fades into the scene where Anita Ekberg is posing for Dean Martin. and it's the same pose. But Lewis, because a man is not supposed to assume that woman's objectified, erotic, hip-thrusting pose, that's why he becomes paralyzed. And isn't he actually saying, as Martin is carting him off to the chiropractor or whatever, isn't he actually saying, I can't straighten up, I can't straighten up?
Yeah.
Right? And then we see the torture that he's being put through in order to try to get Jerry, like, this is what the whole movie machine, the whole plot machine is doing. This is Laura Mulvey applied to queer studies. It's better than her own analysis, right? All of the pressure and torture being applied to him to get him to straighten out, right? And then it ends up with him kind of calling Martin in as if they're going to have sex. This is an excuse to give us, Martin and Lewis, having sex, and we've already seen them in the bathtub together in this movie.
No, they're not in the bathtub together.
They are in the bathtub together.
Oh, well, okay, he falls in.
Oh, yeah, he falls in because this isn't a movie, this is real life, and accidents happen. No, Dave, they're in the bathtub together.
Okay.
Okay. So, yes, it looks like we're going to basically get Martin and Lewis making out. But that can't happen. So then Lewis has to call in another lady and another lady. Is there another lady and another lady until we have this human pretzel that he then extricates himself
yeah,
from?
Yeah, he's not part of it. He's just watching it.
Yes, exactly. And that is the Lewis character. That is what has to become of his sexuality under the constraints of heteronormativity and cinema, Hollywood cinema.
Dean can handle six ladies at once.
Yeah, and I'll set it up for him. And they're all these, yeah, copycat blondes again, other than I think that might be Kathleen Freeman again in that scene.
It sort of looked...
It pretty much looked
like her. Yeah.
So what else needs to be said?
Well, it's really a good-looking film, I must say.
Gorgeous, yeah.
The Technicolor is great, or Eastman color, I think it is.
Yeah.
Or is it?
Oh,
is it Vista color? Which color is it? It's Vista Vision, for sure, because it's Paramount, but which color process?
Eastman, it is Eastman color. And how about that Jackson Pollock reference at the beginning, when the businessmen under the billboard of the woman's lips get doused in spectacularly colorful paint?
Sure.
It's amazing. Looks gorgeous. Looks fantastic. I feel like this is... And 1955, that is prime Jackson Pollock year, isn't it?
Probably would have been near the end. Really comes to prominence in the 40s.
Okay. But he was used, so they say now, during the Cold War as a symbol of American freedom.
Well, all of the abstract movement, that's definitely a big part of the argument now. Encouraged by the CIA to get artists away from thinking about social issues.
But it's a nice pop art juxtaposition of the high and the low from Tashlin, and just looks great. Of course, I want to end this reading by saying that the reprise of When You Pretend at the end refers to when you pretend that you're not gay and you're forced into two lavender marriages, as we are at the end of this film.
That's a valid reading, although the movie certainly does the opposite too, right? So it's too confused to have a univalent reading. Because
no, I don't think it does. I don't think it does at all. That's the argument I'm making, which I think is good.
Yeah, I agree with
you. But you can certainly give that reading to the ending, and it is delicious.
But on the other hand, the supercharged sexual nature of the weird Jerry Lewis, Shirley MacLaine pairing makes it seem like, no, this is not a lavender marriage. There will be sex here.
Well, there
against
is
all odds.
Yeah, there is an element of polymorphous perversity to it all, and particularly to their characters, that kind of transcends sexual identities.
Right.
And, oh, and then, I mean, you could just go on and on and on with every scene. What about the scene at the beginning of the Artists and Models Ball where Lewis keeps looking for a woman and he can't. He just gets piles of tool, just piles of nothing, and only Martin can find the women. So again, it goes back and forth between the Lewis character is gay and the Lewis character is just sexually frustrated and can't get a woman.
Yeah, he needs someone like Shirley MacLaine.
And then what about that pink erection woman?
Yeah, that was weird.
What? Just what? Isn't that the one he actually manages to uncover at the end, who turns into the pink erection? I don't know. Full stack. It's just very Henry James name there.
Do you know that that is a very common term these days? Full stack?
No? What do you mean?
It's a job title at many software developer companies. Full stack developer means someone, I guess, that can do a whole range of software development tasks.
Well, yeah, you feel like this character is maybe a proto-engineer type?
I guess so. I don't know if that term... We were getting started with IBM and MIT computer stuff in the 50s. I don't know if full stack was a term that comes from then or it just happens to have come into use now. But it's fascinating.
Well, of course, it just makes me think of not playing with a full deck and
yeah, of course.
And erections.
What about the nature of Dorothy Malone's sexual frustrations and tribulations?
Oh, yeah. So she tells Martin in their first serious encounter where he's trying to seduce her in her studio when he stalks her back there. She tells him that I have all of the same biological impulses that you do. So, you know, that seems progressive. But she stalls him over and over and over again. I don't know how to read it. I don't know if it's just typical gender stuff of I can't seem too slutty. I can't put out too easily. Or if she's sort of supposed to read like a frigid lesbian on some level. Like, I don't know I don't exactly know what's going on there.
She says she was sort of activated by the kiss, but she's not happy about it because she wants to be kissed by someone other than him. Someone, I guess, that she has more respect for at the surface level. Anyway, that's what the movie is about. She comes to realize that he is someone that she wants to be with.
Well, it is pretty standard, though.
Of course, very much so.
It's a standard. Their courtship plot is much more standard than the queer characters.
So there's probably a lot of other stuff to be said about artists and models. One thing we just didn't get a chance to do, I'd like to understand if there's any relationship between this film and the 30s artists and models starring Jack Benny and Ida Lupino, directed by Raoul Walsh. I've never seen it, so I don't know if they just took the title and that's it, or if there's some kind of reference back.
Well, Jack Benny and Jerry Lewis certainly don't have very similar comedic personas.
No, Jack Benny is more of an avuncular type.
Rather than a nephew type.
Yeah, exactly. Now we jump ahead 9 years to 1964 and Billy Wilder's Kiss Me Stupid.
So this was a movie that was devastatingly misunderstood at the time and for quite a while afterwards by critics.
Reviled.
Reviled as smut.
My Leonard Maltin movie guide from 1990, which I think I want to start bringing into the podcast, maybe next time. I just think it'd be fun. I think he represents
what he thinks the average moviegoer wants to know.
The average viewer who's interested in all eras of filmmaking.
Is there such a beast?
But is not particularly academically inclined, right?
So that's, I guess there is such a beast.
Of course, and there certainly was in 1990. Maybe yes. Less so now, but it really worked well for me when I was in my early teens.
Well, there's still TCM, so there must still be.
Exactly, and what he says about the movie is that it was condemned as smut at the time and still seems like it, but it has its defenders. And then he says, maybe in 10 years, ... And indeed, its time has come, I think. I don't think that we're really even very transgressive in arguing for this as one of Wilder's greatest films.
Well, I don't know. I don't know if it's... Certainly, I've encountered essays arguing against its historic reception. I don't know how widespreadly it's regarded as one of his greatest, but definitely by me it is. After one viewing, this is now the second viewing, it is furthermore it's got, like Artists and Models, I guess, it has a problematic relationship to the objectification that it is its subject matter, but essentially, as far as I'm concerned, it is a soft-hearted, sentimental feminist movie.
Yeah, it seems to me that it is a quantum leap forward from whatever Wilder was trying to do in The Seven-Year Itch.
Okay, which is a bad movie, with a good performance by Marilyn Monroe.
It has its moments, but obviously it needed the fine-tuning that goes into this film, and the extra components that Wilder loads onto it.
For one thing, that is a pretty, as far as I'm aware, faithful adaptation of a Broadway play, right? Whereas this is a very, very unfaithful adaptation of a very popular Italian comedy that was produced all over the world.
Unfaithful in every way.
So it is based on the play Laura della Fantasia, or The Dazzling Hour, by Anna Bonacci. A biography of Wilder that I found says that he would have been familiar with the French version. It was translated into a French version and became a big hit in 1953 in Paris for Jean Moreau, who was not getting good movie roles yet, but became a stage star thanks to this part, because apparently one of the actresses who was in one of the two main roles, you know, the wife and the whore, one of them fell ill, and so Moreau decided to play it as a dual role, and that made her reputation.
That's pretty interesting. So Wilder saw it in Paris?
I don't know. But that was the translation he was familiar with. It wouldn't surprise me if he saw that production. I did read an essay suggesting that, again, sorry, I can't tell you which one it was, but I did read an essay suggesting that he would have thought this was the sort of thing that would go over with his audience, like that he wasn't expecting necessarily this reaction. He wasn't necessarily expecting that he would be this provider. provocative because Irma La Douce was also, you know, kind of a smutty hit French play. So why not? Why wouldn't it succeed again? Well, because you're setting it in the United States.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, it really should have been the other way around. Irma La Douce, I do not find to be very good. I mean, neither. I haven't revisited it in a long time, but it really annoyed me.
Well, I mean, in the first place, I also haven't revisited it in a long time, but regardless of whatever ideology it might have, I just didn't find it funny.
No, Jack Lemmon is really irritating in that movie. Shirley MacLaine is always great. That's just a fact of life.
And in The Apartment, they're both great.
Right. Here we don't have Jack Lemmon, but we do have his wife, Felicia Farr.
So I did quite a bit of reading about the play it was based on, and I bought it. I did not read it, though. I only skimmed it. But from what I can make out, I'm about 99% sure that Wilder's main innovation was the scene between the two women.
Well, that really makes the movie great. Without it, it's hard to see how it would have all tied together properly. So good work, Wilder.
Well, yeah, not only that, but it really emphasizes that the underlying theme of it is that it's a women's story and not the man's story.
We wouldn't have that reading without that scene. It would be a totally different movie. So thankfully he put it in and it makes it a different movie.
And I don't think there's any ambiguity about it being the woman's story in the original play. There is here because Wilder usually, at least once he gets going in his career, he usually has a male protagonist.
Yeah, well, he's got the same kind of guy as Tom Ewell in The 7 Year Itch, except a little bit more violent.
But this is also a remake of The Apartment in a lot of ways. With, what's his name?
Yeah.
Obviously, originally this was supposed to star Jack Lemmon and Marilyn Monroe, or whatever, and then he had to
get Ray Walston, my favorite Martian.
Yeah, Ray Walston. So obviously Ray Walston and Kim Novak end up bonding in much the way that Jack Lemmon and Shirley MacLaine do in The Apartment over the same sort of idea where originally he's going to pimp her, basically, and then he changes his mind once he gets to know her.
Right.
And realizes that they're both in sort of the feminine position in this horrible society that they're living in, so they might as well bond together.
A society that puts Dean Martin at the top.
Yeah, this is a movie that starts with a rape joke.
Yeah, for sure.
Now, a lot of this stuff that we're seeing surely was part of Martin's act, but I can't imagine that joke being part of his real act.
Well, it might have been, right? But I think it was always intended, and you could see just from the way Dean Martin kids his own image throughout this film, right? He is talking in this way because it's expected, but he can't actually live up to any of the talk. He has to run away from Vegas in order to avoid following up on the sexual exploits that he's been advertising.
Yeah, and yet he still needs to get laid every night.
Well, that's true. And it's always hard to tell in this movie until the end, I guess, where I guess that part does seem to be true. But is he just saying that because it's expected or what?
Well, he's certainly not insatiable.
No.
He just wants to get laid by one woman every night.
Right.
He can't satisfy half a dozen.
No.
Every night.
No, that would be hard. So the stage is set with this nightclub act before we ever get to small town Nevada, climax
and
Nevada.
The one waiter who's doesn't laugh at any of the jokes and also is wearing his cloth on the wrong arm.
Yeah, he's just out of step. But Dean Martin, he's got a TV show to go to, he gets on the road, and it's his story, and we stumble into the world of Ray Walston, small town nebbish and piano teacher, who somehow managed to marry the most beautiful woman in town.
Yeah, and of course that's an aporia, like you never really know why.
Well, we hear their story. Right?
We do, but I think it's kind of a comment on the trope of the beautiful wife and the homely older man in media in general.
Yeah, for sure. But he knows there's a mismatch here. It's just tearing him apart.
Right.
To the point where he's assaulting teenage boys.
Yeah, this boy who's supposedly 14.
Leveling accusations against anyone that comes to the door.
Yeah, like the super hunky milkman.
This is no life for Ray Walston. This does not make masculinity look good, that's for sure.
There are also endless movie references. There's the grapefruit, there's when he tears the shirt off the boy, there's like a streetcar reference.
Okay, I guess so.
Oh yeah. Also, how do you like those floppy phallic cacti in his front yard. Oh, right, and the name of the town is Climax.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We get a sort of vignette of their life together. She's going to the dentist, and he immediately suspects. Anytime she's out of his sight, anytime she's out of the house, there's a secret assignation going on. He has to call to check up on this. And his worst fears are confirmed. She's not at the dentist. They're laughing at him. His wife is off somewhere else, probably with the milkman, or with the teenager, or with anyone handy that isn't him.
But this whole jealousy plot, well, it's really just setting things up for him to get extra jealous when Dean Martin appears.
Yeah, but, I mean, they really play it to the hilt, don't they?
Oh, yeah, it goes on for a long time.
And that terrifying music that rumbles onto the screen every time he gets a notion that he's about to be cuckolded.
There's also his buddy, Barney.
Yeah, they're a songwriting duo.
Right, and Barney just, like, there's just this long, long scene where Barney's just singing this terrible song. And you can just imagine Wilder just falling on the floor laughing at this stupid song that I guess he and Diamond wrote.
Yeah, well, the music is by the Gershwins, right?
What?
And I think they just rewrote some of the, or maybe they even used lyrics by, because it says music by George and Ira Gershwin. Maybe this is like a throwaway song by them. I have no idea. That would be something to look into. But maybe they just use a Gershwin melody and wrote some goofy lyrics for
it. I don't know. It sounds like Diamond and Wilder wrote those lyrics, but I have no idea.
I'm a Poached Egg is the big one.
Yeah.
Although it's not the one that becomes a hit. That's Sophia.
That's a great romantic title. I'm a Poached Egg.
It's the irregularity that gets them.
It's like You're the Top, except moronic.
Exactly. That's exactly what it is. The Mona Lisa. Ray Walston knows he better hit it big soon, or it's just accepted by both men that she will leave him, unless he can start buying her
more. Of course, it by no means looks like she has any intention of doing that.
No.
Unless he drives her away with his insane jealousy.
Exactly. No, she's not a demanding wife. She doesn't ask for anything except his affection and to stop being accused of being a cheating spouse.
It's pretty funny, that whole scene where he's trying to provoke an argument and he can't. Until the end, then he really succeeds.
Right. Starts laying into her mother, and she's like, well, basically I agree with you. And then when we see the mother, well, he is right about that.
Yeah, well, that's one reason I married you, she says. Just to get away from her.
So yeah, it was a bad home life for her, and you could see why she's willing to put up with his fits of jealousy, because I guess sometimes it's okay, as long as no men are anywhere near the building. And the role that Barney plays in this film, it's expanded, but it's kind of similar to the Krahuli character in 7 Year Itch, who's that plumber, I guess, or handyman, or whatever he is, who just puts all kinds of insinuating ideas into Tom Ewell's head.
Well, yeah,
you've always got a guy like that in Billy Wilder movies.
Barney is an unapologetically terrible guy. Although, then he ends up in cahoots with the wife at the end, so he's redeemed somehow.
Sort of, yeah. Yeah, I mean,
he's that character who is just, he's not the hero, so he's just thoroughly, unapologetically reprehensible. Like, he treats Kim Novak terribly.
He sure does.
But he's just accepted. He's just, like, accepted as part of the community, right?
Yeah. Well, he just runs his gas station, and he's trying to make it big as a songwriter.
Well, I mean, part of the comic community. That's why he's not punished at the end. Only the husband. Only the hero.
Into all of this comes Dean Martin. And so these guys, they need Dean Martin. They need him to listen to their songs. If he sings one of them on TV or in Vegas, they're set for life. Ray Walston can then buy all the things that he thinks his wife wants from him. Everything will be hunky-dory.
Now, in the play...
Are they songwriters in the play? Is it an opera or what is it?
In the play, I'm going to go by the French version anyway that Wilder was familiar with. It's a village church organist who wants to have his new oratorio performed in London. The man who can do this for him is the influential sheriff of London who is passing through town. And okay. I guess looking for a good time, just like Dean.
Right.
So, but this is a very accurate and yet fascinating transposition in order to put this focus on, again, on American culture and what its entertainment is like. So Dean Martin is the comic books. Dean Martin, the nightclub performer, is the comic books in this movie.
Yeah. Now, I guess it's a nice touch that Ray Walston actually is the church organist in Climax, Nevada. He and his wife are church church-going folk. We meet their minister and some of the people that go to the church. Actually, everyone goes to the church, even the barmaids and servers.
That's true. It's a closely knit community.
So again, we're getting...
But they're doing it for public relations. That's, sure. That's what we hear.
Yeah, but who is doing it for non-public relations reason? I guess maybe the minister? The minister, by the way, is the voice of Piglet. Mm. And also the voice or the character who gets possessed by Jack the Ripper in that Star Trek episode.
Okay.
I don't know his name. They've got a good name in town and they're supposed to be clean-minded Protestant folk, but obviously all Ray Walston thinks about is his wife getting nailed by everyone in town.
Right.
Dean Martin, he's not in the business of making hicks in Climax, Nevada happy. He just wants to get the fuck out of there and they have to play tricks on him to get him to stay.
Right. So that's Barney because he is the unscrupulous character.
Right. Ray Walston would never have thought of such a thing.
Yeah.
He does.
Nor would he have thought of prostituting his wife or, failing that, getting a prostitute to pretend to be his wife.
Yeah. Now he does go along with following Dean Martin into the bathroom everywhere and whistling his tunes, but that doesn't work.
Yeah, he gets very upset when Dean sees the dressmaker's dummy based on his wife's figure.
Well, yeah, but that's all after they fucked with him and destroyed his car. So he has to stay overnight, and now the deal is he's going to have lodgings with the Walston family.
I don't know why he doesn't immediately worry about this, but he starts to worry when his wife says that she's seen Dean passing through the town and pulls out the records.
No, he was worried already. He was worried when Dean is ogling the model.
That's before, I guess, the dressmaker's dummy?
Exactly.
But yeah, so this is much worse, though, once he finds out that she has had a crush on him since she was a teenager.
She was the charter member of the Dean Martin fan club at her school.
Right.
And I guess they would have been, probably she would have been a fan of Dean while he was doing the Colgate Comedy Hour.
Sure, and the Martin and Lewis movies. They were getting swamped by teenage girls.
Right. So this is a huge issue, and he can see where it's all headed, and he and Barney put their heads together and come up with, well, again, I guess it's mostly Barney that suggests this is what needs to be done in order for you to keep your cool and also get these records sold. He hasn't met your wife yet. We'll just get some other woman who doesn't mind being groped.
Well, this is all Barney doing this for himself.
Well, yeah.
And the clincher, as we've said, is when he points out he's going to lose his wife if he doesn't become a success.
Exactly.
So then there's the whole sequence where he's trying to get her out of the house and he's maybe going to commit an act of domestic violence for that purpose.
Right. He really doesn't want to do that, but...
No, but it's a pretty weird joke.
It sure is.
But we don't actually get treated to the grapefruit and the kisser?
No, no. It's always looming there. But then
the minister grabs
the grapefruit.
Takes the grapefruit because he's on a low cholesterol diet.
Yeah, they get interrupted several times. There are a couple of scenes that just sort of amplify the tension with the shower and some butt taps.
Right. So the wife and Dean Martin, with mistaken identity, tap each other's butts. So this is pretty risque for a mainstream movie in 1964. And also her mention of Playboy when she thinks her husband is proposing that they have sex in the afternoon.
Right. But, you know, the thing about it is the movie is definitely communicating that she really likes having sex with this weird guy.
This is true. She has a healthy sex drive and she's not choosy.
So she's like, oh yes, let's do that right away this afternoon. So there is...
I don't know. Maybe he's really good at sex.
Well,
maybe
he seems to be, right?
That explains it all.
Exactly. That's what I'm trying to say.
Well, Billy Wilder was very successful with women. He certainly wasn't any Prince Charming in appearance.
No, exactly. But he also probably was chewed up by anxiety.
Yeah, I mean, you would imagine so, despite the fact that he actually was an enormous success. We're just going to do a little biographical reading here and then move on.
Well, it's so prominent in Wilder's films, it has to be biographical, right? He's exploring that.
Sure, sure. Well, we've talked about Sternberg in that regard, so...
So, this nice... And it's their anniversary, and it all turns into such a terrible ordeal for the husband and wife here. The husband hating to do this, but feeling like he must in order to preserve his marriage in the future. The wife just totally unaware of any of the reasons behind this sudden about face that he's taken?
Well, she seems to know he's a real handful and has just figured out it just has nothing to do with me, right? So she's managed to keep her own sanity this way.
Well, yeah, but he doesn't usually attack her like this. He usually talks about his jealousy issues, but this is something else again, right? He's picking fights with her in every way he can think of. Finally, he hits on the right nerve and that's it.
Which was that again?
I don't even remember.
She gets so mad and leaves. I don't remember either.
It's so anxiety provoking that I just can't deal with it, watching him abuse her like that. And like, what's the thing that's finally going to send her over the edge? And by the end of that sequence, I just don't even know what he said to make her run out of the house.
And she leaves in a robe, doesn't she, that she wears for the rest of the movie? Or, well, for the rest of that night, which is most of the movie.
Yeah, she goes off to her parents. And of course, we check in with her over there. It's even worse. She goes to a bar and gets hammered. But that's for later on.
So who is this actress?
Felicia Farr.
Felicia Farr.
She's really great in this movie.
Yeah, so she was married to Jack Lemmon.
Right.
She did not have a very robust acting career. Some television, few movies. Too bad, because she's great in this movie.
Absolutely. There's no shortage of talent on display here. She gives just the right note to this character.
She's sweet, she's confident, she's canny.
Yeah, everything should be great with this couple. If Walston could just calm down.
He's just got too much anxiety.
I guess a lot of people don't like Ray Walston in this movie, right? They think there's something off about his performance.
No, he's perfect.
I think it really works. I think it's better than Jack Lemmon. I think it works.
Well, first of all,
that he's a much older guy.
And also, who needs Jack Lemmon playing an anxious Billy Wilder character again?
Exactly. Exactly.
Let's mix it up a little.
No, I think this is really perfect. But I think that when people identify a weakness to the movie, if they're not objecting on moral grounds, often they're objecting to him.
No, I think it worked. I don't find it a laugh out loud funny movie. It's funny, but it's not.
No,
it's not laugh funny movie.
Upsetting than anything.
It is. Like the first time we watched it, we were pretty shocked. But then it turns out that it's all okay in the end.
Yeah. Exactly.
And then the second viewing was kind of warmer, knowing that.
Sure, you know that its heart is in the right place.
Yeah.
At this point, we meet Kim Novak. And, you know, another favorite of the show, I think, we can say.
Well, I think you might be particularly fond of Kim Novak, but I certainly have time for her.
Oh, yes. I absolutely love Kim Novak in everything. I don't find her to be in any way a limited performer. You often get that.
No, I don't think she's a limited performer. She's a weird actress, but I don't think she's limited.
No, she's terrific. I guess there's a little bit of Judy Barton in here.
There is.
I wouldn't say that there's a lot in common with her Vertigo performance.
No, just that wistful desire for someone to love her so that she can settle down and be okay.
Yeah, and in that movie, it's Jimmy Stewart, who's even older than Ray Walston.
Well, yeah, she's not going to be picky. As long as the guy isn't a disgusting wolf like Dean Martin, that's all she's looking for.
Yeah, and we see what her life is like at the bar. I mean, it's terrible, but she's managed to figure out a way to survive it. You know, she always blocks the gropes that come her way.
She's a variation on a lot of different Wilder characters. The Shirley MacLaine character in The Apartment, the Sugar Cane Marilyn Monroe character in Some Like It Hot, who also Tony Curtis comes around to not using.
Right.
But in a different way. And also, of course, Sugarpuss O'Shea. I think Per Outfit is a definite reference. But the characters aren't very similar.
No, I wouldn't say so. But yeah, that's right. He did write that movie.
Yeah. Ball of Fire. I'm talking about Barbara Stanwyck's character.
Sugarpuss O'Shea is a lot more powerful in her cultural milieu.
Wilder goes on, he increasingly gets interested in a sentimental way in this fallen woman figure, for sure. And examines gender through that prism, and also through his use of Jack Lemmon. My romantic comedy essay, I think, touches on that, if I recall, talking about how Sugarpuss O'Shea is less a Wilder heroine than romantic comedy heroine of the 1930s. And by the 1960s, you're working with a completely different type of actress.
Yeah. And the character Kim Novak is playing, Polly the Pistol, she's in a terrible, just an unbelievable situation. You could have made one of the most harrowing tragedies out of her life, right? She tells us her whole life story as the movie goes along. along. She got involved with this guy. They took this cross-country trip, and it turns out it was all about him getting her money away from her and leaving her stranded in the middle of nowhere without a car even. And she's just been stuck there ever since, forced to work in this awful bordello, basically, and actually have sex with men when the bartender sends them over to her to try to get together enough money that she never will to get a car to leave this awful hell. But she's not really self-pitying. You know, she's just like, well, this is my life. I've come to terms with it. I do my best.
And this is where everyone gets this idea that I can't agree with at all. Although if you were just going off Double Indemnity, then yes, I could see how you'd get there. But this idea that Billy Wilder is cynical, because, I mean, his vision of America here is of, Tashlin's vision of America is that it's just fucking crazy, just lunatic asylum. But Wilder's vision is that it's a hell. But within that, he himself is very soft-hearted.
Yeah, and Kim Novak, you know, the one thing that she's not bitter, she's not cynical. She is somehow a wonderful person. She doesn't want to hurt anybody. She's got her life there. She doesn't want to be stuck in Nevada, but she's made the best of it. She's got her parrot.
Her parrot who keeps watching violent TV and going bang, 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 bang.
Yeah, the parrot is the American television audience. Yeah, and the American comic book audience, if you're referring back to the last film.
And then the bang, bang of violence becomes a bang, bang of sex.
Right.
With Dino.
She's responsive to her environment in the best way possible. She sees the good in everything, really. And that could be really a gross trope if you want to go the pretty woman direction, I guess. But I just find it really works in this film, because it does not try to turn anything into a fairy tale, right? Wilder really
it kind of is a fairy tale by the end, though.
But not in the pretty woman.
Well, no. Well, I mean, we see that, we see and hear that she has had these traumatic experiences. Even just the landscape of that desert behind the belly button and her trailer, right?
Yeah, and her fairy tale ending is just getting a car and leaving. That's it. Like, she doesn't get a prince or anything like that. She's just getting another chance to do something with her life that she might enjoy.
And her future, of course, is to try to find a man that's like
Ray Walston.
A man that's like Ray Walston, but then never keep from him the fact that she's been a prostitute. Well, let's hope actually she finds a man just like Ray Walston, and she doesn't have to do that, and it'll be like Jack Lemmon and Shirley MacLaine in The Apartment. Walston has actually no prejudices about prostitutes. He's never given it any thought, whereas Barney has all of the prejudices, and she's just an object to be used.
Oh yeah. He just strolls in there and offers her the $25, knowing she has no choice but to accept, and drags her back in his pickup truck.
And thinks that's all she's good for.
Yeah. He doesn't give it a second thought. Dean Martin's role in all of this is just to be the most disgusting version of American manhood, entitled American Manhood, that one could possibly imagine appearing on screen.
I mean, I guess it's probably been suggested that there's some dialogue going on here with Jerry Lewis's portrayal of Dean Martin in The Nutty Professor.
I guess so, sure.
As a very despicable, objectifying character. The Mr. Hyde character as a playboy.
Right.
Yeah, but of course this is like far worse, and Dean Martin, I guess, is showing that he can play an even darker version of that character than Jerry Lewis came up with.
Oh, much darker, right? Because it's more believable that this is exactly how many men do behave every day in American society.
And yet he never feels, he's gross and disgusting, but he never really feels powerful in the scene. He's very infantilized.
Sure, because he's just gotten everything he wants for so long now that he's kind of forgotten about the threat that lies back of celebrity and multimillionaire status. So he gets to just totally enjoy it without having to feel like the bad guy. And I think that's really fascinating and maybe the most pointed aspect of the film. Like, Dean Martin is acting like, hey, this is just a boy's romp. Right? He's not laying it on thick as if he is a melodrama
rapist.
Exactly. No, he's just like, I'm just going to do my usual thing. Eventually it's going to work out and everyone loves me. I'm Dino.
But even if it doesn't work out, it doesn't matter because this guy needs me to buy a song.
Yeah.
So I'm going to get this in the end anyway. Which is when he gets tired, when he gets bored, that is what he resorts to eventually. And what he gets bored with is the fact that they're not playing the game that everything was set up for, which is the man offering him his wife so that he can seduce her. Even if she's reluctant, that's fine. But instead of that, they start bonding in front of him, and that's when he gets bored, because he's just being completely excluded.
Yeah, he's not able to deal with that very well, although he doesn't know what else to do, so he has to keep trying to chip away at it and seeing what he can offer as an incentive to get Orville off to the bowling alley.
But... They are making spaghetti together. That's when they do their bonding before Dean wakes up, right? Yeah. Just like Jack Lemmon and Shirley MacLaine in the apartment.
Not with a tennis racket.
Right.
But it is Orville's jealousy that breaks that whole impasse and brings him back to the house. And
how dare these celebrities, these rat packers, think that they're entitled to the wives of us ordinary men?
And just like Jerry Lewis in Artisan Models, Ray Walston somehow becomes incredibly powerful here and heaves Dean Martin through the air, the much larger Dean Martin, through the air off the porch onto the ground outside of this little cottage. And of course then he has to go to the belly button club to try to assuage his urges.
Yeah, because he's pretty unfazed by everything that's happened. He's just a little annoyed.
Yeah, well, he's like, look, where's this club again?
Should have just stuck with that in the first place.
Yeah, why did they even make me eat that spaghetti? Yeah, he just moves on. So that's how he avoids seeming like a total villain. He's not trying to get revenge. He just knows it doesn't matter. He's been thrown out of the house by Ray Walston, and rightly so. So he's just going to try the next door and see if he can get what he needs out of the evening. He gets some comedy value out of the time he spends at the bar.
And of course, you were saying from your documentary and podcast listening that the real Dean Martin just preferred to stay home and knit of an evening. During the Martin and Lewis era, like, the rumors were that he was sleeping with everything. The rumors were actually that they were both, but certainly Dean.
Well, I think he did sleep with a fair number of women, but it doesn't seem like he put himself out very much to achieve it. And he definitely...
Well, he wouldn't have had to in that period.
He definitely spent most nights in bed by like 9 o'clock, right? And they kept talking about how one of his favorite things to do was when his wife would give parties where a lot of celebrities would show up, he would call the police in the guise of a neighbor and get them to shut the party down so he could drift off watching TV.
But this fake version of Martin, I don't even feel like he is driven by any lust or libido. He just doesn't know what else to do with himself.
Well, that's what I've been saying. Yeah, he's not at all sex mad. You get to the pinnacle of the ladder that is presented to American manhood and there's nothing there. Right? At the top.
Yeah, and then, like, what do you do with yourself? You're gonna fucking read a book? Like...
No, you just have to continue to exemplify what's supposed to be up there for these men that can't even dream of getting to the top. You have to keep sleeping with every woman that comes near you, or at least have it be rumored that that's what you're doing, because that's what all men are supposed to want to do.
Yeah, exactly. But in the end, the wife does benefit from this. So we then follow her adventures. First of all, her mother annoys her so much that she leaves there, and she shows up in time to look through the window and see a strange bacchanalia going on, where Kim Novak and Ray Walston are so excited that he sold his song that they are wildly dancing around together, while Dean Martin is collapsed in a corner watching them drinking wine out of her shoe.
Yeah, and Dean Martin, of course, is the only thing that the wife can't see, so that's still left as a surprise for her at the end.
So, having seen this, and I guess with Barney's help, she puts it all together and understands what's happening. Well, I don't know. Does she? Does she know that... I can't remember if at that point she knows.
No, she doesn't.
She must, because she ends up selling the song. She ends up selling it. That's part of the plot.
I don't think that Barney has anything to do with that. That's just that she puts it together with,
I guess,
what Dean is talking about. Yeah, it's like, I spent the night with some screwballs, and what men will do to sell you a song?
She figures it out then. She understands the picture that she's seen then.
It's not Barney doing all her thinking for her. She does all of it. We get to see her do some pretty good detective work, which is impressive for someone who's as hammered as she was earlier in the evening. But she passes out.
She's fully recovered somehow when she wakes up, and you just accept that dramatically.
Yeah, well, it's like Clark Gable in Test Pilot. You just sleep for an hour and then all that drunkenness is gone, right?
Yeah, she shows up at the belly button. She gets really hammered. The women who look like rejects from the Blue Angel cabaret, you know, the Blue Angel Lola Lola is the only, like, remotely sexy woman on that stage. It's kind of the same vibe with these roadhouse girls, waitresses. Anyway, they don't want this housewife, this hysterical housewife, making trouble, so they escort her out to the trailer because they know Polly's not there.
That scene is so funny when she's yelling at the jukebox. She keeps saying, "Gentlemen, play something else!"
Yeah. So we've got the exact stage scenario of the kind of the bed trick, a famous comedy plot device, ancient comedy plot device. But what we seem to be set up for here, given the state that she's in, and given that we know that Dean is on his way, and then we see Polly being recommended to him, we think we're set up for a rape scene. Like, yeah. On a first viewing, it was dark.
But no, Dean comes in and they have a talk. He's bemused by all of his experiences this evening, and his desire to relate this to her enables her to figure out the entire story. And she puts in a good word and uses some and reverse psychology on Dean.
She's not at all, like, she's totally unflappable through all of this as she puts it together.
I know, it's amazing. It's a great performance.
And then she puts it together, the further bit of the equation. She has to get over a little bit of reluctance, a little bit of propriety, but she further puts it together how she can fulfill her fantasy of sleeping with Dean and make her husband's career at the same time.
Yeah. So she's like, you know, you're not...
She nags him.
She totally does. No, it's not really for you anyway. You can't... You're passe.
Yeah, you know, it's for one of these rock stars.
Yeah, or even Eddie Fisher, like younger crooners. Dean is... He takes the bait and starts crooning Sophia and realizes, oh yeah, this does sound like
and
a
then,
Dean
yeah,
Martin
that
song.
Becomes... Her fantasy is to sleep with Dino the crooner, right? So she's actually put in the mood.
Yeah, it's
by
a little bit of
sing.
Foreplay for herself as well. And then they have sex, and just because of how Dean thinks about sex, or this version of Dean, he has to pay her a huge amount of money for her trouble. Meanwhile, back at the house, the pretend marriage gets real.
He's not a cheapskate.
No.
You can't say that about Dino.
No, again, he's like, let's make this fun. Here's $500. Go buy yourself something nice. What happens between Orville and Polly, it is really hard to describe, but the movie makes it seem quite nice somehow, right? That they just get so into pretending to be a married couple that for one night they just are.
Well, he also...
It's like the Enchanted Cottage or something.
He understands what it means to her, so it's kind of empathetic on his part. You really do end up believing it, that he's not just indulging himself in an affair.
No.
I mean, the cliche, I don't know what he's doing, but of course the cliche is the whore who wants to be treated like a wife, and the wife who, for one night, as she says, wants to be treated as a whore. There are aspects of the movie that touch on realities of sex work, but the basic plot is a fairy tale.
Yeah, and that's the crude reductionist version of the story, and some of it is just, it's really there in the structure, but a lot of it is kind of
in the tone,
questioned and interrogated as well, which is part of what makes it so great. But yeah, they do consummate their fake marriage. There's an afterglow the next day, but it's over.
Well, and she says to him, because this is the magic, and Billy Wilder always loves to use the comedy trope of masquerade. There's an element of magic to it. It really is a fairy tale. And when she says to him, like, he's starting to feel guilty, and she says, no, I was your wife. And you have to just accept that, yeah.
It's transubstantiation.
Yeah,
she
absolutely.
She has become a sacral version of his wife. So that justifies everything that happens, and presumably that's why it's allowed under the code or whatever.
I don't know. Like, he got in a lot of trouble with the...
The code still existed at this time.
With the
Hayes
office?
It certainly was weakening.
Yeah, he got in a lot of trouble. It's all documented, and I still don't know how he managed to do the things he did in this movie.
Well, they don't show sex happening, but it's certainly...
Implied.
Yeah, I don't think that there's any way for an audience member to think that it didn't happen.
What's the money for?
Right.
And then, yes, so the scene between the two women.
Yeah, and that conversation is just amazing.
And the wife, on this viewing, I was intrigued by the fact that the wife doesn't know that Polly needs this money and gives it to her anyway. I mean, I guess she can guess that she does.
She just assumes, and rightly so, that no woman would be in this position unless they were stuck there with no route out.
Yeah.
And that's, the movie's awareness of how economics and patriarchy work together to put women in these positions.
Right. And anyway, she's already made the fortune of her family, so what does she need this $500?
Exactly.
And so then this strange ending. So Polly recommends, like, she's smitten with Ray Walston. This is exactly the kind of man that she'd like to have for her herself. So she recommends that Zelda just forgive Orville, because, you know, he didn't mean any of it. It was all with the best intentions. But she has other plans, because it's a fascinating character because it's a meta character. It's the character who holds, kind of stands a bit outside of the play, has all of the knowledge, and manipulates events a bit.
And that's making up for the fact that at the beginning, she's just caught completely unawares by this grapefruit potential assault and all the insults he directs at her for no reason. He calls her eyes pink. But by the end, she knows more than everyone else, definitely.
Even though we don't really feel that there's anything that he needs to be punished for now. And even though she's understood everything that's happened and she likes Polly, Walder and Diamond have set this up so that they've heaped so many sins of patriarchy upon him, even though he's sort of an unwitting agent of them at the beginning of the movie, that now she has to contrive some sort of trial to put him through.
He does need to be punished for his behavior before Polly ever came along.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
His jealousy is not acceptable. And she's been putting up with it, but she doesn't like it. So if she can cure him of that with some shock therapy, then she's definitely going to try it, it sounds.
Yeah, but what does this all consist of? Well, first of all, it consists of pretending she's going to divorce him.
Right.
And then on the eve of the divorce actually happening, what she's really meeting with him about is the performance of his song by Dean on TV.
Yeah, so the sale has been made.
It's a little bit like the ending of The Lady Eve, in which the man, even at the end, hasn't put all of the pieces together.
Well, no, he hasn't. That's why the last line is just kiss me, stupid. He still doesn't know what's going on. He does have his wife back and his songwriting career, but he doesn't know how it happened. And he's never going to know.
No, unless he puts it together.
He's not going to put it together. He's stupid.
Just like Henry Fonda, he'll never know that this was the same day. Well, no, actually, Barbara Stanwyck says she's going to tell him, but this woman isn't going to tell him.
She's not going to tell him. No, it's been all for her, ultimately. And it seems like they're going to have a better life together, but she's the architect of it, and he's just the beneficiary of her quick thinking. And Barney gets to benefit as well, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, he's rewarded for evil. He's the character who's rewarded for evil. This is what I'm saying about the comic structure. So the hero gets punished for evil, but also rewarded, and Barney just gets rewarded.
He does. Although his life looks pretty sad anyway. I mean, he doesn't have anything going on except for trying to sell these songs.
Well, he doesn't appear to care.
That's true.
So how does she manage to end up in this position, do you think? Like, by what rituals has she gone through that she ends up in this position of knowledge and of rearranging her marriage so that it's to her liking?
Well, obviously some of it is just narrative magic, because she's not really in a good place when she's yelling at the jukebox. It's just the fact that she happens to be escorted to Polly's trailer, spends some time there, and soaks up some kind of cosmic wisdom about what patriarchy does to women and what the challenges are and what the opportunities are. And just because she's got a different vantage point on things and a different class background, she's able to take advantage of all of it.
She's sleeping with Dean in the full knowledge of how revolting he is.
Sure.
He's come to this trailer to sleep with a prostitute.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not exactly the number one fan's dream come true, I don't think.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So she's really accepted the dark side of patriarchy and is going to try to make the best of it.
Yeah. Well, I would think that that would cure you of any hero worship that you might have.
And yet she still kind of enjoys it, because she's, you know, she's probably a little dirty too.
That's what enables her to look behind the curtain of reality.
Yeah. Because she is this bourgeois person who is put in a completely different subject position, but she still has, as you say, this privileged consciousness that lets her...
She's not going to be victimized or taken advantage of, because she does have this.
It's her own little Sullivan's Travels.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's a good way to think about it.
I certainly don't understand. Okay, I guess I do understand, but I also don't understand. Insofar as this movie was ever considered sexist or misogynistic, it's like, it's absolutely the opposite.
Well, it is. But if you take any of it at face value, it is the vilest thing ever put on screen. So people are pretty literal minded, unfortunately. That's not something that is any different today than it was in 1964.
And this is one
it's worse now.
This is one thing that satire is, I guess. It is a thing that is pretending to be its opposite.
Right, like Starship Troopers. You know, the classic example from our own lifetime, condemned as a fascist film. It's the reverse. So Kiss Me Stupid is exactly the same thing for rape culture. And not recognized at the time. Only little glimmers of recognition occurring now, possibly. Anything you want to say to sum up sex satire in American culture?
No, I think we've said it all. Did you enjoy this special subject?
Good pick, Elise.
As we wrap up, I'm just looking at the information in this biography, Some Like It Wilder, The Life and Controversial Films of Billy Wilder. And yes, indeed, I'm a poached egg, as well as Sophia. They were written by Ira and George Gershwin. I'm a Poached Egg was an early discard, which was reworked for the film to make it sound even worse.
Great. Well, from early discards to Discord, at least, we do have a Discord server for There's Sometimes a Buggy. We started it a couple weeks ago. It's just the two of us right now, but you can join us anytime you'd like. Just send us an email and we will invite you.
I am by no means convinced that we have the size of audience that will have a large enough percentage to keep up a lively discourse on Discord.
No, maybe
but
not.
But all we'd actually need is two articulate people, two people who like to chat a lot, because we certainly can do that.
Yeah, we certainly can, and we'd like to have you there. Now, we'll put up little things that maybe aren't available anywhere else. We'll put up our schedule when we change it in maybe a more readable format for you. We'll put up images, maybe some extra discussion if we get around to it, or if you want to trigger any, or ask us any questions, or tell us what you've been watching. All of that can be done on the Discord, all available for free. Just ping us, and we will bring you into this wonderful little world of internet clubhousery. And next week on the podcast, Elise, it's Daniel Day-Lewis, Part 6, The Crucible, and The Boxer. So the final Sheridan Day-Lewis collaboration in The Boxer, and pretty interesting adaptation of The Crucible, from what I recall. I did see it in the cinema in 1996.
Well, that was a play that was absolutely shoved down my throat as a teenager in high school, that I still shudder at the memory of that, but it will be interesting to revisit it from a new perspective.
With a new screenplay by Arthur Miller in 1996. Winona Ryder's in it as well, so we'll get to see that pairing once again in a totally different era of American history.
And we'll see you then.